We're back once again. This is Greg, aka Crazy G, from NECR New England Concert Reviews. And once again, we are here with another amazing and talented artist. He and this band, they spawn a few genres. These guys originated out of New York City. He is from the band Dope, and he is the main man himself, Edsel Dope. Hello, welcome. It's an honor. Thanks for hitting us up here at NECR. What the hell is going on? Man.
Hey man, you are too kind with that introduction. I greatly appreciate that. All is well out here, brother. We're on our third day of the tour. We're up Seattle, Washington right now. We started out in Sacramento, then we went to Portland, and now we are in Seattle for the third show, and we're just starting to get into the swing of things.
Awesome. That sounds great. Honestly, where do we even begin? 20 years. I have to congratulate you on this. It really is a major accomplishment, and Dope has been doing this for 20 years with much success. Briefly, what would you say, or could you say, is the key, so to speak, for a band to even last that long in this industry today?
You know, that's a good question, man. I'd like to give myself a little bit of credit for being just a workaholic and having just a tremendous amount of ambition and self-drive, but there's also something to be said about, there's just a special chemistry between us and our fans, and I call it like the band-to-fan connection, and you can't fabricate it, you can't buy it, you can't, you know, record labels have tried through the course of time to spend money on things and make them successful, and, you know, we're a band that has been through every single facet you can go through. Our first album came on a cassette, and now nobody even buys downloads anymore. It's all about streaming. So we have survived every single, you know, evolution of the business and done it at a sort of cult level. You know, Dope was never a big multi-platinum artist. We're not the Eagles. We're not Disturbed or Slipknot. We've always sort of just had our niche and done our thing, and just this connection that we have with our fans that brings them out time after time when we go on tour, it just seems like they're always there for us. And, you know, I could tell you what they say about us or what they like about us. I mean, we always try to put on a great show. We always try to make records that are very true and honest, and, you know, we're very committed to the full 360 package of having, you know, great music videos and great artwork in our records and great live shows, and we make ourselves very available to our fans. But, you know, I don't know, man. I just, again, you can't fabricate it. You can't, there's no roadmap for success. There's no guidebook for this. I feel very blessed. I'm very grateful that we have so many fans that continue to find us as much as we put out content to reach them. They seek us out, man. There's something about the chemistry between what we do and what they do for us that just works, and I'm grateful for them. They're grateful for us, and it's a great relationship, and it really is a relationship, and, you know, that's the best explanation I can give for it.
Very cool, and yes, I'm predating myself. I remember cassettes, man.
Me too, bro. It's crazy, man.
Let's touch upon your newest CD for a couple here. We'll get into your work ethic. This new CD, Blood Money Part 1, I read up on the press, and I have to say, you are an enigma. Your work ethic is unmatched, and in an excerpt, it states, and I quote, "All of this has combined to make Edsel an unstoppable Renaissance man." How do you perceive that title, and what would you like to tell us about the making of that CD?
You know, I don't even know what that means. but I mean, the making of the CD, this one took longer than any one prior to it, but it was more because I just needed a break, man. For the first 12, 13 years of my career, I did nothing but live, breathe, eat, and die this band. It's all I did. It's all I cared about. I sacrificed my own mental well-being. I sacrificed relationships with people that I loved. I put the band before everything. And that was what I needed to do. And there sort of came a point in my life where I sort of realized that it was becoming lonely, man. Like, you know, when you put your passions above your people in your life that are important to you and support you and your loved ones, you know, at some point it's going to wear thin on everybody. And, you know, the heavy is the head that wears the crown. You know, you find yourself alone. And that's what I started to do. I started to realize that I was alienated from a lot of the things I had worked hard for and the things things that were important to me aside from the band. So I really needed to kind of check out for a little while and not spend my life on the road and not spend my life in the studio and sort of reconnect with the human being that is Edsel Dope, as opposed to the sort of machine that I had kind of turned myself into that just did nothing but write, record, tour, write, record, tour. And I took some time off. And during that time, I kind of reconnected with my humanity and my family and just my soul, if you will. And through that time, continued to write and record music, but at my own pace. And then I reached a point where I felt like, okay, it was time to get back into this again, because I'm kind of one of those people, I can't half-ass anything. I'm either all or nothing. So I finally put the finishing touches on Blood Money, and then we went over to Russia, and we made a live album with all the, you know, the classic Dope songs. And we put that live album out, and we did a big tour, and then we dropped Blood Money Part 1, and now this is our third tour in 12 months. And again, man, I'm very grateful, I'm very humble for how it's all gone down. And I think after this tour, it's probably a good idea to maybe go back in for a year and record some more and start to prepare for the 20-year anniversary of Felons and Revolutionaries, which was our debut album, and do something really special to celebrate that and the tour on that, and at the same time sort of start putting the finishing touches on Blood Money Part 2. And I mean, there's so much to think about and so much to be done, but somewhere in the middle of all that, you gotta have a life, man. You gotta take care of yourself too. And that was missing from my life. Me taking care of myself and the people around me was missing. And I'm glad I reconnected with all that, because I feel like I'm a much more well-balanced person. And, you know, for lack of better words, I just think I'm a better human being. Being more well-rounded is, I think, just a healthier place to be. So it's all good, man. It's all good. Don't know if I answered your question well, but...
No, that's perfect, dude. And that's why I called you an enigma for your work ethic. And I have to agree with you. This did very well for you, because this CD seriously rips it up hard.
Thank you.
The self-titled track, Blood Money, this thing causes much madness on this CD. What do you want to say about this track, and how did you want it to reflect and or work on the CD as the self-titled track?
I mean, it really kind of encompasses a lot of the things that I said in my previous statement, where for 16 years, at the time that I had written the song, it was 16 years of the band, and it was 16 years of sacrifice and 16 years of my own blood, sweat, and tears and love and passion. And the song just kind of talks about all of that sacrifice and, you know, and the sense of blood money. I translate that many different ways. Like, it's just been a crazy time, you know, a time where I feel like I have pushed myself to the absolute extremes. And I wanted to make a song that, you know, really felt like Dope 2017. It was nasty and dirty and had all the guttural, you know, intensity that people have grown to love in Dope, but also, you know, a little bit of that, you know, modern day breakdown in it. It just feels like an evolution of the band while not losing the spirit of what the band was, with, you know, screaming middle fingers and a slight story in there about everything it took to get to this point. I'm very proud of that, but I appreciate you picking that song out yourself, because, you know, it's one of those, it's weird, when you have 6 albums plus at this point, you know, and you go on tour, you play an hour plus every night, you can't play more than a few songs off each album, and Blood Money is the song that we definitely feature off this new album more than any other, and I feel like it definitely represents what the band is about. If you hear that song and you don't get the band, then you probably won't get the band, and I'm okay with that. And the video for the song, too, if you have a chance to watch the video for Blood Money, I mean, it really, it's the spirit of Dope. If you don't dig it, then you're not going to dig Dope. It very much ties the room together.
Oh, I dig it, all right. I checked it out. Another badass track is 1999. Briefly, what's the story behind this triumphant track?
You know, it's kind of the similar spirit to Blood Money, where, like, you know, the band hit the scene in 1999, and what a crazy time to be a young punk with the world by the balls and touring the world and partying my ass off, and, like, and there's the duality meaning to it. There's, you know, the fact that I survived literally through, you know, from 1999 on till now, and then figuratively just the fact that the band has survived so many different changes in the industry and is still here today, when, you know, it's not a very forgiving business, and it's a business that once you're not the flavor of the month anymore, anymore and you're not on a major label and you don't have the support of the industry, most bands die. And this band hasn't, you know, for all the things that we talked about earlier. And I'm very proud of that. And the fact that, you know, literally I've seen friends and colleagues pass away, like their own life no longer exists on planet Earth. I mean, so many people that we grew up touring with aren't even walking on the planet anymore. And then so many bands that came out at the time don't exist anymore. And the fact that, you know, I'm still walking around on planet Earth with Dope tattooed on my knuckles, with an army of fans out there and still playing shows. And again, not being one of those chosen darling bands that sold multiple millions of albums like Disturbed or Slipknot, and great bands, you know. But we were, you know, we were always more of the fringe. We were more of a cult kind of band. The fact that I can still be alive figuratively and literally both as a band and as a human being, it's a blessing, man. So that song sort of talking about that, just how it's pretty amazing that I'm still here and we're still here and we're still doing it, and we still got it cranked up to 11, and it's as real and raw as it's ever been. I'm very grateful and proud of that.
And you should be, man, because I'll tell you, like I said, and this is a tough business, man. I don't care who you are. To survive it as long as you guys have done it, especially, and I don't mean this in a bad way, but you've had a lot of artists come through the doors of Dope that have helped make the sound. And I want to get back to one more question as far as the CD goes. One of my favorites is Drug Music, and to me it's a musical massacre of sound, to say the least. And we could talk all day long about this CD, but my question to you is, what would you say was the most in-depth track or challenging for you to put together on Blood Money Part 1, and why?
You know, I'm gonna say probably the song Hold On, just because I really got naked, man. You know, one thing I've always done is, I feel like our records have always been pretty white, and I've never been, you know, there's always the Blood Money type tracks and the 1999 tracks where, you know, you turn it up loud and a double middle finger's coming at you, and I think that's what people tend to expect from us. But if you're a real fan of the band and you've listened to all six albums, there's always fringe tracks. There's always tracks on the record that expand where the band is at, and usually they're more personal, and they're songs that kind of take you into, like, the humanity of who Edsel Dope is. That's just a guy, just like any other guy, that feels pain, that loves, that loses, that, you know, has a big heart, and our hearts get broken, man. We're human beings, and we love, and we lose, and we achieve, and the song Hold On was super personal for me, and was a big growth in my life of losing somebody that I love dearly, and a lot of the reasons that person was lost was that my own mistakes, my own choices to make other things priorities in my life. And so making that song and being as open and naked as I was with it, and then making the music video for it that was equally open and naked, because I had to be true to myself. I had to express it in a way that was going to help me heal. It was going to help me to move forward, because it was such a trying time for me. There's a song called A New Low on the record as well that's sort of telling that same story. And then there's also a really dark song called Lexapro. Those songs together as the three, I feel like, were the most personal and the most, like, difficult to write and even listen to, man. Like, I listen to those songs and, like, I kind of sound like a big pussy, but, like, they make me want to cry, dude, because they're so personal and so, it's easy to be angry. Anger is an emotion that, for me, I developed very early, and a lot of the reasons that I was so angry is because I didn't know how to deal with pain, didn't know how to deal with sadness or depression, so it came out as anger and venom. The older that I've gotten, the more in touch I've gotten with myself as a human being, the more I've realized that, you know, it's okay to hurt. And if you hurt, maybe you need to express it as pain as opposed to expressing it as anger. And oftentimes you'll get a different reaction from people that are close to you. If you're hurting and you lash out at somebody, you're probably going to lash out back at you, or they're going to shy away from you, and then you're going to find yourself alone, you know, or isolated because you're vile, you know, you're volatile to them, so they retreat. But if you express pain and sadness to somebody, they'll be more open to listening or to being supportive of whatever it is that you're going through. So that was a big lesson for me to learn, that my pain was oftentimes expressed as anger. And I think a lot of human beings do that. A lot of young people especially that haven't learned how to deal with pain pain. They feel pain and they lash out. And I think it's important as you grow up that you learn that it's okay to feel, it's okay to hurt, and it's okay to express that you're hurting to people around you so that they can comfort you and help you to not hurt anymore. And a lot of times expression of anger all the time is a very lonely place. It's not something that I feel like, you know, is a place that is healthy to live in all the time. So those songs that are more human, those songs where I had to learn to express pain, sadness, suffering, I think were harder for me, but also very necessary for me to grow and become a better man.
I think you hit the nail right on the head with all of it. I have to agree with you. As we get older, I think I like to use the term mellow out a little more. I think we still get angry, but I think we can deal with it a little bit better because we've gotten more experience and we've gotten more mellow in some aspects. And maybe take that extra second, as you said, with, you know, taking a break and dealing with what you got to deal with and spending the time with who you need to spend with.
Sure.
Well, Dope continues to annihilate everything it does. Dope also has announced the release of a retrospective collection. Dope, the early years, New York City, 1997 to 1998, the original storybook and soundtrack of how it all began. What would you like to tell us about this ultimate Dope collection?
It's a really cool thing, man. What it was it just kind of hit me that the 20-year anniversary of the band, you know, being an entity is like upon us. And what I did was I went back into the vault and I found the 20 demos, like the early demos that I recorded in my bedroom that ultimately got spread across New York City, and which, you know, on cassette, that ultimately led to us getting our record deal and then going in the studio and recording our debut album. So I took those 20 demoed songs that most people out there have never heard, and if they have, it's on YouTube and somebody, you know, ripped it off a crappy cassette so it sounds like shit. And we remastered them so they sound as good as they could possibly sound. And then I sat down at my computer and I just started to tell my story of how it all began and how the band, you know, came to be from this imaginative idea to actually being something real, and how I met each one of the guys early on. And, you know, then I went through some old boxes in my attic of all these pictures that I had from back in the day, and I pieced together a really cool introspective photo booklet that walks you through the very beginning all the way up until we played those first shows in New York City and signed our deal with Epic Records, and then it kind of leaves you at the point where we were becoming a national band. So it's a really cool, like, for a real hardcore Dope fan that wants to take that journey with us of how it all really began before the rest of the world was introduced to the band in 1999. This is the behind-the-curtain look, the soundtrack and the storybook to 1997, 1998, when it all began. And we made a very, very limited number of these. We're not putting in retail stores. We're not selling the audio on iTunes. You can only get it direct from us at www.dopetheband.com. And it's just a really cool package. Again, it's kind of something I did for myself because I really just wanted to, like, put it all down in writing and look at it all, and, you know, something that someday I'll get to my kids and just say, like, this is how it all started, and, you know, stuff that never got released because people really, for the most part, heard about this band in 1999. But there was, without this two-year period, 1997, 1998, there wouldn't have been a Dope in 1999. So it really is the most important, most crucial time of the band's story, and I felt like it was something that I just wanted to tell and wanted to share with people. So I think that the fans that are interested in that sort of thing will be really, really happy when they get their hands on it, and I think that they'll appreciate the depth I dove down with it, and I look forward to getting it in their hands. They're going to start shipping in December, so that way people have it for Christmas, and then we'll be celebrating our first show that we ever played. It was March 18th or something like that of 2018. Will be the 20th anniversary of that first show, so it's coming up on us really quick.
Very nice. Yes, that's sweet too. It sounds like a great collection to grab.
Yeah, man, it's a really cool thing for sure.
Dope has just started, as you mentioned, the Monster High Tour 2017 with Head PE and El Nino. First of all, what do you want to tell us about this tour quickly and playing with these two sensational bands? And you have three New England dates coming up on 10/19 at the Whiskey Barrel in Laconia, 10/20 at the Clatter in Lawrence, and 10/21 at the Fett Ballroom in Providence. Anything you want to say about about those particular shows?
Well, first off, unfortunately, the Massachusetts show got moved. It's now in Manchester, New Hampshire. Same date, but it's in Manchester, New Hampshire now. So if you want to email our publicist, Tom George, who you set this interview up with, he'll get you that final information so that way we can make sure that, the people listen and know. Because I don't know the venue, but so that's that. But it's really cool because we've never done a proper tour with Head PE our entire career. We've never toured with Head PE. We've actually never toured with El Nino either. We've played spot shows with them here and there, but this is the first time that we've actually put a proper tour together with either of these bands. So shocking because we've all been around for so long. But yeah, we're having a really good time. We've known all these guys for years, but now we're actually out here to, and able to tour with them on a daily basis and have a tour plan from the get-go. It's a really cool thing. So just we're getting into the swing of it now. We're 3 days into the tour. We got a lot of time left and we're all buddies. So we're just going to come out here and do what we do and put on a great show for the fans every night and shake a bunch of hands, sign a bunch of autographs and just create some good memories and continue to do what we do. And who knows, man, maybe 20 years from now, we'll still be doing it. It's crazy, but who knows, right?
Hey, I'll still be listening to you if I'm still kicking, I'll tell you that.
I appreciate that, my brother. I appreciate that.
Well, listen, Edsel, I want to take the time right now to give you a huge thank you for myself, NECR New England Concert Reviews, for giving us your time. I wish you the best with everything. The new CD, Blood Money Part 1, Part 2, this tour. It sounds like you've taken a step back and you've reinvented yourself in some aspects, and I can't wait for more from Dope. I wish you the best, man.
Hey, man, I really, really appreciate that, and we appreciate you and spreading the word, and, you know, we all meet each other in this industry, man. It's a small little world. It's a little community, and we really do. We appreciate you, and we appreciate all the fans, and we look forward to seeing you guys up in the Northeast.
All right, man. Hey, I thank you for that as well, and, you know, be good and keep rocking, man. Keep pumping that shit out. It's great.
You got it, my brother. We'll do.
All right. Peace, man. We'll talk soon.
All right, buddy. Have a good one.
You too. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was none other than the main man himself, Edsel Dope, for the hard rock band Dope. Check out the new CD, Blood Money Part 1. They're coming around. Check them out. Check out their website, Facebook. Get the CD and check out their retrospective collection. This is Greg, a.k.a. Crazy G, for NECR New England Concert Reviews, and I'll be back. Peace. Later.